Hello, welcome to this presentation. My name is Denis Lacabane, I'm biochemist, and I'm working mainly on big proteins that I studied by NMR. So today, in this video, I present the concept of specific labeling and specific unlabeling for NMR spectroscopy. The principle is simple. The selective labeling consists in adding specifically labeled amino acids into your minimal media, which is in natural abundance. Whereas, the reverse labeling consists in adding natural abundance amino acids into your minimal media, which is labeled 13C15N. For the selective labeling, you add what you want to see, while for the reverse labeling, you add what you don't want to see. So what you have to do is to prepare your amino acids. You dissolve them and into water or buffer. You check the pH because you can get some surprise, and you transfer your amino acid solution into your bacteria culture 1 hour before the induction. How does it work? Here is the map of the metabolism of amino acid in Escherichia coli. What we see is only the metabolism related to the carbon and from the glucose. For the nitrogen, yes, it's a different map. For instance, if you want to label only the isoleucine, you add the isoleucine into your culture media. The isoleucine will inhibit its metabolism pathway in Escherichia coli, and it will be directly incorporated into the protein. How does it cost? For natural abundance amino acids, the price is less than 1 euro for 0.5 gram. However, labeled amino acids are quite expensive. That's why you have to be careful during the process of production and purification, and you must not forget your sample selectively labeled, as example in 15N lysine, in the fridge, for instance. All these prices are rough estimation found in some companies' catalogs. So you can see that the cheapest ones are the 15N amino acids. Sometimes it is also cheaper to buy 15N, 13C amino acid than only 13C labeled. But yes, for which purpose? First, in order to see the resonances. In the case of a huge protein or a complex of proteins, selective labeling can be very useful. For example, by using methyl labeling coupled with methyl trozy experiment, you can get a very nice spectrum of methyl labeled from a very huge protein. Huge here means up to 200 kilodalton, and you can even reach 1 million dalton if you can increase the temperature of the sample. So I put this very recent review, which summarizes nicely what you need to know about the methyl labeling. But in most of the cases, selective labeling is used in order to help for the assignment process. Indeed, in the case of spectral overlaps, due to alpha helical structure, as example, or because the large size of your protein, it is useful to identify spin systems corresponding to the different amino acid types selectively labeled. This can be achieved with selective labeling or reverse labeling. To illustrate my point, here there are 9 samples produced with different labeling schemes. The sample 1 to 4 were dedicated to the assignment. The combination of amino acids strongly depends on your protein sequence. Here, this pattern was used and was enough to get a near complete assignment of a protein. So we will see later why some amino acids were not selected here. Sample 5 and 6 were dedicated to the methyl labeling in solid-state NMR, and 7, 8, and 9 for liquid-state NMR. As you can see, you can almost get information from all amino acids carrying a methyl group. So we saw the assignment. So now let's mention the restraints. With collection of restraints, you will get a much more crowded spectrum. So if you don't want to get another crowded spectrum with ambiguous restraints, selective labeling is the key. Here, the author put a nice example of what you can get with methyl labeling. You have these 4 methyl groups, which are specially close, and consequently, the 3D RFDR solid-state NMR spectrum displays the cross peaks corresponding to the distance restraint for the methyl presented in the structure. So here I'll take another example, an extreme one. It's a 2D with 150 mg mixing time from solid-state NMR from 600 amino acid protein. So yes, at 150 mg of mixing times, you can only detect short-range molecular distances. So, but without specific labeling, it is almost impossible to analyze anything with this overcrowded spectrum. Whereas, by using reverse labeling, you remove what you want to remove. So here, because it's a membrane protein, hydrophobic amino acids are overrepresented. So here, isoleucine, valine, and leucine, they compose 30% of the protein. And if I remove them, you can see that all the short distances from the C-beta of the alanine and the C-gamma of threonine are completely isolated. Without proline, isoleucine and valine, the short distances can be clearly seen here from the threonine and even from the serine. So I have decided also to remove the lysines because they share the same area than the arginine side chain in the spectrum. So now I have no ambiguities about the residue. In the last case, selective labeling can be used in order to get specific information. I will give you this example. So the sample is the rhodopsin, which covertly binds a molecule of retinal. Here, to see if the mutant binds or does not bind the retinal, the rhodopsin was labeled only with 15N lysine in order to see the formation of a shift base between the protein and the retinal. So this information was obtained by DNP. And as you can see, the correlation between here the carbon from the retinal and here the nitrogen from the lysine. So yes, there is the retinal is correctly bound to this protein. You can see on the spectrum. The rhodopsin is a membrane protein which is light sensitive. Light induces a conformational change. So here the author decided to selectively label only tryptophan. Why? Because there are only 5 tryptophan in the protein, so it is easy to do a single point mutation and assign all of them. They also have a good reporter about the state of the protein. This tryptophan here is in the binding pocket, as you can see, and these 2 tryptophan are also very good reporters about the conformation of the protein regarding the presence of light or not. So another point, as it is a membrane protein, so the bovine rhodopsin is studied in detergent. So in this case, you have to deuterate the protein. However, the protein here was expressed by Ehrlichia cells, so mammalian cells, which means that you can almost forget the use of deuteration. So as a result, the authors use tryptophan, which is labeled, and by using that, the tryptophan will be incorporated by the cells in the protein, and the side chain are dynamic enough to be seen by liquid state NMR without any deuteration. So this is a very nice transition about the expression system. Indeed, selective labeling can be used for all expression systems, but concerning all these systems, even with cell-free, you have to be careful regarding the scrambling. So you have to choose and choose wisely your amino acid selection to avoid this scrambling. So what is scrambling? As you can see in the metabolism pathway, some amino acids are strongly connected, whereas some of them are located at the end of the lines. This connection leads to interconversion between amino acids, and this is called scrambling. If, for instance, you add some threonine into your media, you will inhibit the generation of threonine and the bacteria will use directly the threonine that you have added to the media. However, threonine is also a precursor of 6 amino acids. So if you add labeled threonine, you will also get labeled isoleucine, labeled glycine, serine, and also labeled tryptophan, but only on the backbone. Here in these 2 matrix, this is the effect of the amino acid added into the media on the other, on the protein. Here in the 15N, you can see that isoleucine, leucine, and valine are connected by the transaminase. So, if you add 15N leucine, you will also get some 15N isoleucine and valine. And here, for the 13C, as I said before, if you add some threonine, for instance, you will get some scrambling on glycine, isoleucine, cysteine, serine, and tryptophan. So just to remind you that these two matrices concern only Escherichia coli. It is quite similar for the other organism, but you may find some differences. For bacteria, you can check on ECOSYC, and for the other organism, you can also check by using CEQ. And so to conclude, we saw that selective labeling or reverse labeling is very useful to see resonance or to vanish them, to help for the assignment process and also to collect restraints and get specific information. So you have a lot of choice in terms of amino acids. So, but because labeled amino acids are expensive, so I put here a kind of list of the minimum concentration that you can use. But it's purely indicative. It may change a little bit regarding the protein expressed. And for reverse labeling, you have no limitation because the price is extremely low. So you can also use selective labeling for the methyl labeling. So I did not talk about the glycerol labeling, but I put here these three nice references. So these two are the references in terms of glycerol labeling, and this reference is a combination of glycerol labeling and reverse labeling. So with that, they did the assignment, they collect the restraint and the structure of the membrane protein. Finally, you can find much more information in the literature, of course. So with these two special issues from the Journal of Biomolecular NMR or this book dedicated to isotope labeling. Here I put references for the cell-free with general information, especially on the scrambling due to the transaminase. Also the methyl labeling by cell-free, and here a nice example of application from the work of Aaron Slaines and Vlastimil Girascu. Here you can find some more information on methyl labeling with a bacterial system. So this reference is a protocol, so very nice. And to finish, I would like to thank the Ampere Society for this new format and for inviting me to present this very nice topic. And I would like to thank you for your attention and for watching this video. Merci beaucoup.